On February 1st, 1960, four black college freshmen, Joseph McNeil, Franklin McCain, Ezell Blair Jr., and David Richmond, sat down at whites-only Woolworth's lunch counter in Greensboro, North Carolina. Their stand against segregation ignited excitement and motivation for other step sit-ins across the country.
Historians often label the time in the South after Reconstruction as the era of the New South, which suggested something different from the Old South. Mainly the abolition of several million former slaves, the New South was supposed to be a changed South, but in fact turned out to be nearly identical to the Old South. Black codes were replaced by Jim Crow laws, and slavery was replaced by tenant farming, another form of slavery for many. That's how things were around places like Greensboro, North Carolina in 1960. That's the way it was until four college freshmen, tired of being treated like second-class citizens, decided to challenge the way of things that had always been done. "We didn't want to set the world on fire, we just wanted to eat," said Ezell Blair.
Not since 1942 had anyone gained national attention using a sit-in protest to desegregate a public cafe, and that was in Chicago and in Illinois, a place far different than Greensboro. Sit-in participant Joseph McNeil was inspired to organize a sit-in after he viewed New York City where he encountered no Jim Crow laws. Yet upon his return to Greensboro, he was denied service at the Greensboro Trailways Bus Terminal Cafe. Frustrated, he was determined to do something about it.
In 1959, McNeil, McCain, Blair, and Richmond attended an NAACP meeting at Bennett College, where they collaborated with experienced civil rights protesters over tactics and how to create a plan. Benton's College was Greensboro's only women's college. Several ladies from Benton's College, known as the Benton Bellas, helped the four technical college students plan and execute their first sit-in.
The four men agreed on Greensboro's Woolworth's department store as their target location for the sit-in. As a variety store, Woolworth's had a lunch counter. Blacks were allowed to shop at the Woolworths and eat at a stand-up-only snack bar, but they could not sit at the lunch counter. The night before they planned the sit-in, the men could not sleep. They were nervous and even scared over the physical and emotional violence they could possibly encounter the next day.
The next day, February 1st, 1960, they traveled to Woolworths and sat down at the all-whites lunch counter. The weather that day had been unseasonably warm, but by the late afternoon, when the students approached the Woolworths, temps were beginning to drop. They were glad they'd worn their coats and ties in an effort to protect an image of professionalism.
Upon entering the store, known as a variety store or Five and Dime, the men bought the everyday things they could normally buy at such a store. They bought toothpaste, a comb, a book, along with a few other items before they turned to the real purpose. As they approached the lunch counter, a whites-only lunch counter for as long as anyone could remember, a rush of adrenaline pumped through them.
They could smell the frying of the eggs and ham in the kitchen and hear as the machine spewed soda and ice cream was turned into milkshakes. Their senses were unusually super active in addition to the sounds and smell of the kitchen. They sensed something else. When they stepped across the threshold from the store to the cafe, they were very aware that such a simple move of crossing an imaginary line could get them arrested, beaten, or even killed.
These young men had tragic understandings of the importance of their actions. All of them could remember when young Emmett Till was tragically murdered in Mississippi in 1955. Had Till's life not been taken from him, he would have been the same age as Blair, Richmond, McNeil, and Franklin. The four men stood at the threshold, looked at one another, nodded, and then walked to the counter.
Upon sitting down, the Greensboro Four, as they became known as, felt the full might of transformative energy they had read about when they studied Mahatma Gandhi's methods of nonviolent resistance. Franklin McCain said, "Almost instantaneously after sitting down on a simple, dumb stool, I felt so relieved. I felt so clean. And I felt as though I gained a little bit of my manhood by that simple act."
By the time they sat down, the entire store was quiet. Only the usual sounds heard in a kitchen broke the air. McCain said it reminded him more of a church service than a protest. After several tense moments, a waitress walked over and told the students they were not served there. Next, a black kitchen employee came from the back. He too tried to convince the four men to leave. He pled with them to follow the rules. After several minutes, the store manager, Clarence Harris, walked over to the counter and asked them to leave. The frustrated store manager called the Greensboro police chief, who told the manager that as long as they were quiet, he could not do anything about it. They even sent an officer to the store. When the officer entered the store, he had his billy club in his hand. They believed their moments of beating had arrived. There was one final person that approached the four students before the store closed early for the evening. An elderly white lady rose from her seat in the counter area and walked over towards McCain's seat. She sat down next to him and looked at all four of the students and told them that she was disappointed in them. McCain, wearing his ROTC uniform, politely replied, "Ma'am, why are you disappointed in us for asking to be served like everyone else?" She looked at McCain and put her hand on Joe McNeil's shoulder and said, "I'm disappointed it took you so long to do this."
That night, they quickly began calling up other campus student groups they thought might support their cause. On February 2nd, more than two dozen black college students arrived at Woolworths. White bystanders occasionally verbally harassed the students, but no violence erupted from either side. Students from other colleges arrived to support the Greensboro Four, as they became known as. When the lunch counter filled up, student protesters lined the sidewalk in the front of Woolworths and began another sit-in at a nearby store. The civil rights movement for me began on February 4, 1960. Julian Bond, civil rights leader.
What made Greensboro different was that it grew from a heroic local movement into a revolutionary movement. It created an unexpected youth activism campaign that changed the direction of the civil rights movement. Day one began with four students, day two had 24, and by day four it had grown to hundreds, almost all by words of the mouth and newspapers. On the first day, only a single photograph was taken of the four students. But as more students arrived, not just from North Carolina, but all from over the country, the media arrived with them.
Woolworth's African American kitchen employees, Geneva Tisdale, Susan Morrison, and Athena Jones took off their Woolworth's aprons and became the first African American customers served at the lunch counter in Greensboro. Even though segregation was not officially terminated until 1964 Civil Rights Act, Greensboro proved that in 1960s, areas became desegregated when African Americans decided they were not segregated any longer.
Word quickly spread, and after only a few days, students in the other North Carolina towns began their own sit-ins. The sit-in movement began to spread throughout the South and even into the North. Everywhere, African Americans and some whites picketed all Woolworth stores in the South. After 6 months of sit-ins and picketing, on July 25, 1960, the Woolworths in Greensboro was officially desegregated. The Greensboro, North Carolina sit-in was a crucial turning point in American and civil rights history. It catapulted nonviolence on a national stage as a tactic used to push back against Jim Crow laws. It inspired later crucial events such as freedom riders and others who wanted to end segregation throughout the South.
Time brings about a change. Let me tell you time. Whoa.